So we are discussing molecular basis of inheritance, a very important chapter from class 12 syllabus of your board as well as NEET entrance exam. And because we are talking of molecular genetics, therefore the basics become very, very important. Again and again, I am telling all the students who are watching the videos, it is very much advisable to first be comfortable with the basic terms. And then you go into the process itself. So spend some time understanding what is the molecular basis of the things that we are going to actually study in this particular chapter. So in this particular series, what we are going to discuss is a very, very important enzyme, RNA polymerase. So this RNA polymerase will be involved in the process of transcription. I have already told you that the transcription is formation of RNA on the template of DNA, and this process will actually be because of this particular enzyme. This is the enzyme that will catalyze the formation of RNA on the template of DNA. Now mind my words, I am saying formation of RNA on the template of DNA. I am not saying I am converting DNA into RNA. This is a very common mistake that students can casually commit. So you do not convert DNA into RNA. This is a very, very important point to understand. You make a copy of the message that is written on the template strand of the DNA, and you convert it into, say for example, a messenger RNA. If we are talking about protein synthesis, and because the language remains same, that means both DNA as well as RNA are made up of nucleotides, the building blocks of nucleic acid. We are calling this process as transcription. So let us look what we are saying. We are saying that DNA on the template of it, you make a transcript. And I have already described you why this process is actually called as transcription, so I am not going into the detail. And again, before actually seeing the process of transcription, the various steps of transcription that will obviously follow this particular video, I want to be absolutely comfortable with the enzyme that will be actually involved in this step. Very, very critical step. Again and again, I tell students that please understand the process of transcription is a very, very vital step in expression of gene, because later on in the chapter we will also see how we actually regulate the gene expression, and majority of the time we will be actually regulating the gene expression at the level of transcription. So it is absolutely essential that any student of molecular genetics must be very comfortable in these particular nuances, the basics of the topic. Only then you will find it very, very easy later on. So we will invest time in this. So I am looking at this enzyme which is called as DNA polymerase. First and foremost, let me look at the name. Let me look at the name. So I am calling it as an RNA polymerase. Now, this RNA polymerase, I have already told you that on the template of DNA, there would be a structural gene. I am talking in general terms. Let us suppose that the thing that we are transcribing will actually be translated later on or ultimately into a protein. So we are limiting ourselves to a particular segment of DNA that carries a gene, what we say the initial definition of gene, and the expression of it would be protein. But before protein, there must be a transcript form, which is messenger RNA. Let us talk in these terms. So we are saying that we are making a transcript of this particular message on the DNA template in the form of what is called as a messenger RNA. So once you understand this process, it is very easy to understand that it is generally called as DNA directed, sometimes also called as DNA dependent RNA polymerase. So you can call it as a DNA directed RNA polymerase or DNA dependent RNA polymerase. You can easily understand that what I am trying to tell you is that it is on the template of the DNA that you make a molecule of RNA. So this is why we are calling it as a DNA dependent or DNA directed RNA polymerase. Remember in the topic of DNA replication, we used DNA polymerase for the synthesis of the new strand of the DNA. And because we were making DNA on the template of DNA during DNA replication, I call that as DNA directed or DNA dependent DNA polymerase. I hope now this word is absolutely clear why I am calling it as a DNA dependent RNA polymerase. And you will very commonly find this abbreviation RNA polymerase. It will be written something like this, or sometimes some textbook may write it as RNA polymerase. They can write RNA POL, pol. So that these are the two common abbreviations that will be used, but we will be trying to stick to this particular one, and we are calling it as RNA polymerase. I hope the name and the abbreviation first and foremost is absolutely clear to us. We know that this is the enzyme that will catalyze the formation of the RNA on the template of DNA. This is absolutely clear. Now let us see what exactly does it produce. So this is an enzyme. This enzyme will catalyze this conversion. What will be the product of these particular conversions? So we are saying that if this DNA is containing a coding sequence for protein, if the DNA on which the transcript is being formed, mind my words, again I am saying, if on the template of the DNA there is a sequence, we are calling this as a coding sequence. Coding means that it will be making, ultimately reflecting into a protein. Then we say that if we are making a transcript of this coding sequence on particular strand of the DNA, we will lead to the formation of messenger RNA. Now this term messenger, this term is absolutely clear to us. I have already discussed in other videos as well that what does messenger RNA mean. I have already told you in other videos that all major cellular RNAs are formed on the template of DNA. So we are looking at the template of DNA, which carries a coding sequence, which carries a sequence of nucleotides that carries enough code to make a particular protein or a peptide, and we are calling the transcript for obvious reason as messenger RNA. This is the message that will be carried to the protein synthesis apparatus, which are the ribosomes. You are very well aware of this. Number two, it is not necessary. It is not necessary that every sequence of the DNA will actually be converted into a protein. So we are looking at, say for example, I am not trying to say this as in a literal meaning, but try to understand. I am saying coding or non-coding on the basis of the fact that whether it makes a protein or not. So therefore, if we look at, say for example, the other sequences that will not be converted into protein as such, what are they going to make? So they may make what is called as ribosomal RNA. As I told you that that all major cellular RNAs will be actually located on the template of DNA. So we will loosely call them RNA genes. Actually, we will call them RNA genes. So there will be RNA genes. They will not be translated into protein. Please do not misunderstand the use of the word coding and non-coding here. I am using the word coding if it is making a protein. Otherwise, I am calling it as, say for example, non-coding part of the DNA. It does not mean that it does not code for anything. It is carrying a code for ribosomal RNA, because we know that this ribosomal RNA will not be translated, and hence we are using the word non-coding. I hope the correct context is absolutely understood by everybody watching this video. So these ribosomal RNAs will make up what is called as the structure of the protein synthesis apparatus, what are called as ribosomes. So this will be the function of ribosomal RNA. It there will be some genes that will be actually transcribed into what is called as tRNA. Here this T means transfer RNA. I will discuss in detail this particular molecule when we will discuss the process of translation. Again, some very basic concepts that are very often neglected by the student in a haste. So please understand, very important basics. So there are some particular genes on the DNA that would actually be transferred transcribed into a transfer RNA molecule. As the name implies, this transfer RNA molecule will be given the function of transporting the amino acid in the cytosol, binding to them and transporting them to the ribosomes, where the messenger RNA will take the message from the DNA. So that means very simply, if I try to show you diagrammatically, say for example, this is the ribosome and this is the messenger RNA that actually contains the transcript of what is called as DNA molecule. So there must be a RNA molecule that will actually bring the ribosome here and to this particular assembly point. And this particular RNA molecule is called as a transfer RNA molecule. So non-coding part, we will include the transfer RNA as well. And you will see that sometimes there will be some other type of RNAs that may be formed. There is a very important term that I will like to introduce, what is called as micro RNA. Now please understand, the micro RNA would be involved in the regulation of the gene expression again. And this regulation of gene expression thing, you will understand more clearly in the unit of biotechnology. There would be a very, very important phenomena which is called as the antisense technology or RNA interference, where we will be using these micro RNAs for silencing of the gene of a pathogen. So that means, again, you can understand there is another RNA molecule that is not being translated into protein, and we are calling it as miRNA. Please remember that this is micro RNA, this is not mRNA. mRNA is messenger RNA. Let us be absolutely clear about the terminology here. So this is mRNA, where M stands for messenger, and here please see closely, I have written miRNA. This is not mRNA, it begins with M, but do not try to commit a mistake in the entrance exam here. This is miRNA we are talking about, and this mi means actually micro RNA, and they will also be formed on the template of DNA. And last but not the least, this may be the formation of catalytic RNA molecules as well. So there will be the formation of catalytic RNA. We know that almost all enzymes are protein. So we are always reading this, that almost all enzymes are protein. When I say almost all, so I am not saying all enzymes are protein, I am calling it as almost all enzymes are made up of proteins. Now what are those exceptions that actually are enzymes, that means have a catalytic function but not actually are proteins? These are the RNA molecules, and appropriately they are called as ribozymes. So they are called as ribozymes. So we are looking at a spectrum of the products that are actually being catalyzed by this particular very, very important enzyme, which is actually known as RNA polymerase. Now, I hope this is absolutely clear. So we understand that all the term that I was using in the initial videos, that all major cellular RNAs are actually formed on the template of DNA. Now this thing is absolutely clear. I hope you will remember till biotechnology micro RNA, and when you read biotechnology, you will understand the importance of micro RNA as well. We know about ribozyme, but I have reinforced the idea. So this is absolutely clear to us. So now we know that what this enzyme is called, how is it written, and number two, what actually it makes. Now there is another question. Where is it found? In what type of organisms is the RNA polymerase enzyme found? So my answer would be in all living organisms. All living organisms have to make protein. So all living organisms have to make protein, and therefore for this simple reason I am saying that this RNA polymerase would be found in all living organisms. So very, very important property of RNA polymerase, we are looking at as a very widespread distribution of RNA polymerase, and we are saying that it is found in all living organisms. And the way you look at the virus may be different. Some people say they are non-living, some say they are living, some say they are at the boundary, whatever you may like to call. I will include some viruses here. So there are some viruses that will use RNA polymerase. We very well know that RNA can be the genetic material of many viruses, and these viruses, obviously, they will have to have RNA polymerase if they are to multiply themselves, if they are to increase their number even in the host cell. They have to make copies of their genetic material, and therefore I am saying that this is also seen in some viruses. I would like to replace this word as let me say many viruses. Why should I say some? Because there are large number of viruses which are actually RNA viruses. So let us understand this, that I am replacing the word some by many. So it is found in many viruses. Now you know about two semi-autonomous organelles. So from your study of cell biology, you know that eukaryotic cells have some semi-autonomous organelles. Now, these two organelles that we are talking about are chloroplasts. Now, chloroplasts, you know, will be in plants, and we are talking about mitochondria. And do not commit this mistake. I am not differentiating between plant and animal kingdom. Mitochondria will be found in both plant as well as animal. So sometimes when we are in a hurry, when we are under the pressure, when we are under a tremendous pressure actually of the examination hall, this may creep like a mistake in our mind. So when we are saying chloroplasts are found in plants, I am not saying that mitochondria are found only in animals. What I am trying to say, that every eukaryotic cell will have mitochondria, about mature RBCs, etc. But that is an exception. Otherwise, almost all eukaryotic cell will have mitochondria. The presence of these organelles in the eukaryotic cell, I have already discussed with you in other videos, is actually because of an endosymbiosis. Endosymbionts, they are endosymbionts. So that means they were free living prokaryotic organisms, and during the evolution, what has happened, that they have come inside the eukaryotic cell and have stayed here. This is what is called as endosymbiosis. And what does this semi-autonomous mean? Let us have a recap here. That means that they are not entirely dependent on the host cell. So they are not entirely dependent on the main chromosomal DNA. They can make some proteins of their own. So I am not saying all proteins. These are some very, very important points being discussed. Watch my words again. What I am saying, they can make some proteins. So that means this is the autonomy. That means they can make some of their own proteins, but largely they are also dependent for many proteins on the main chromosomal DNA of the eukaryotic cell, where they are actually the endosymbionts. I hope this thing is absolutely clear. And since I am saying that they will make some proteins themselves, so don't you think that the RNA polymerase would be found in these organelles as well? So it is very easy to comprehend now. Anything which is making protein, that means it has to transcribe a particular genetic information, and for that to happen, RNA polymerase must be there. Viruses with RNA as the genetic material need to replicate, need to multiply. Actually, they multiply very fast within the host cell using the machinery of the host cell, and that too will require RNA polymerase. I hope this thing is absolutely clear. So now we know that where exactly is it found. So this is very, very simple. Now when we are saying that they are found in prokaryotes as well as eukaryotes, so again when all living organisms would be meaning that, okay, they are found in prokaryotes and they are found in eukaryotes as well. So we are talking of the cells, you know, these are not having a true nucleus, and they have a true nucleus. We already know a true nucleus is bound by a double layered nuclear envelope. Now, what is the difference between the RNA polymerase that is found in prokaryotes and the found in eukaryotes? So this is a very important question for entrance. The answer is that only one type of RNA polymerase is found in prokaryotes, which will be transcribing all the major cellular RNAs for this prokaryotic cell. So let us take a breather here, and please understand, in prokaryotes there is a single RNA polymerase, and this single RNA polymerase will transcribe all major cellular RNAs in a prokaryotic cell. But what about eukaryotes? Eukaryotes have several. So let us understand, eukaryotes have several RNA polymerases, and they will be transcribing different types of RNA that we will actually see. So I hope this is absolutely clear. This is a very, very important point. I will like you to write it down, that what exactly is happening here. Now, this RNA polymerase, let us look at the name of the scientist who were actually recognized for their efforts and were actually given Nobel Prize for this. And let me show you the name of the scientist with the help of a slide that I have prepared for you. And look at this slide, and we are looking for the Nobel Prize. So we are very much aware of this man, Kornberg. You know about, so I have discussed about this person many times in the discussion of this topic of molecular biology. Now, this scientist was given Nobel Prize in chemistry. So we are teaching biology and we are talking of chemistry. Please remember, most of the important research, actually let me first talk to you. I will come back to the slide. This is a very important point that I want to tell you. Actually, please understand, biology is actually now an emerging branch of science. So what I am trying to say, that a very, very big amount of research is being done in biochemistry. So you cannot understand biology if you do not understand properly chemistry, or you do not understand physics, because we are not immune to the physical laws. So gravity is acting on me. Fluid is being circulated in my blood vessel. They will have to follow the laws of the fluid motion. There would be the diameters of the various blood vessels, and the difference in the diameter will create difference in the resistance to the blood flow as well. All these things are very, very important to us. So when we record, say for example, an ECG, we are using technology. When we are putting a person onto a ventilator, we are actually using technology. These all instruments are actually created by the technologists that the doctors are using. Sometimes I tell my students that in day-to-day life, the amount of technology that we are actually using, not even the engineers are actually using it. Though we are very much fortunate because we have these friends, those who have made for us the very, very important machines that help us not only diagnose but treat very critically ill patient. You take a simple example of a blood glucose checking. You know about a glucometer, so you know there is a strip, there is a particular enzyme that has been adsorbed on that surface. We will call it as, say for example, glucose oxidase, and this type of thing is actually not created by doctors themselves. They are using technology. Well, look at the stethoscope. So that stethoscope helps you listen to the heart sounds, the breath sounds. What is it? It is technology. So you cannot be immune, because I have seen so many medical aspirants very afraid of physics and chemistry. Don't be. Your body is made up of chemicals. In your body there are so many compounds that are being formed, so many compounds that are being catabolized. Unless and until you understand that what exactly is the chemistry of this particular molecule, you will have to cram the things up, and you cannot cram everything about human body. Look at the larger picture. Very soon you will be in a medical college, and you cannot escape hard work. So hard work is the key to success. So now this was a very important message that I wanted to convey to the students. And now let us come back to the slide that I was talking about, the various scientists that are acknowledged all over the world, have been acknowledged by the Nobel Prize, conferring them the Nobel Prize. We are looking at Roger Kornberg, and you know a lot about this particular person. 2006, and he got Nobel Prize for providing detailed molecular images of RNA polymerase during different stages of transcription. So different stages of transcription we will later on see are initiation, elongation and termination. So what happens to the structure of RNA polymerase? This was actually told to us by Roger Kornberg. And this is a spelling mistake. This is Severo Okawa. So SEVERO, this is not P, this is RO, OCOVA enzyme. So you will learn about this particular person in your NCERT textbook. Again, I will also describe. So he was actually given Nobel Prize. This is a very important, you can see the asterisk mark that I have put on this particular point. This is a very important thing to understand. Okay. But this person was given a Nobel Prize for something which they thought was RNA polymerase, but actually turned out to be what is called as polynucleotide phosphorylase, and that will be involved in the enzymatic synthesis of RNA. If you have read your NCERT textbook, clearly you will know that NCERT during the discussion of the genetic code is mentioning this particular enzyme, which is called as Severokava enzyme, or otherwise also called as polynucleotide phosphorylase, very much involved in the enzymatic synthesis of RNA molecule. So I hope this thing is absolutely clear. So we know the contribution of these particular scientists that were very critical in actually letting us understand the functioning of RNA polymerase. Now let us look closely at the prokaryotic RNA polymerase. So I told you that in prokaryotes there is a single RNA polymerase that catalyzes the formation of all major cellular RNAs. So all major cellular RNAs are being transcribed by the single RNA polymerase in prokaryotes. So we will look at this. So this enzyme has a core. This enzyme has a core. Now, core is the main constitution. You can understand. You can understand the name is telling its meaning itself. So, core is the basic thing, the basic structure, the main ingredient of a particular structure would be its core. And this core, obviously, this is a protein. So, RNA polymerase is a protein. And we know that a protein can actually have many polypeptides. So please understand this very, very important concept. In class 11th, you have seen what is called as the quaternary structure of a protein. So many proteins, say for example, hemoglobin, this must be very comfortable for you. Hemoglobin has two alpha and two beta chains. So we are talking of four polypeptide chains, and such type of proteins are actually having a quaternary structure. So we are absolutely sure that a protein can actually contain more than one peptide chain. And this is what happens in the core. So this core will have alpha 1, we will call it as alpha 2. I am enumerating the different polypeptide chain. I will call it as beta, the fourth one would be beta dash, and there is another polypeptide chain which is called as omega. So we are looking at 5 subunits. So that means I am looking at the 5 peptide chains that form the core of this particular enzyme, which is RNA polymerase. Very, very important question. So look at it again. So we are saying that RNA polymerase is not made up of a single polypeptide. It has large number of polypeptides. To be precise, the core of this enzyme, core again means the main structure of this enzyme. Core is the basic structure that is made up of five chains and 5 subunits. We are calling it as 5 subunits, and I am naming them as alpha 1, alpha 2, beta, beta dash, and omega. So if we think something like this, there is an alpha 1, there is alpha 2, and beta, beta 1, and let us say omega. So these are making up the core. And there is an important subunit again. This subunit, please remember this. This is a very, very important question for your NEET and AIMS exam. The other subunit that we will be talking about, which is not included in the core of the RNA polymerase, is the sigma subunit. So we are looking at prokaryotic RNA polymerase, and I am looking a sigma subunit. Now this sigma subunit, you know the symbol of sigma. This is something like this. This is the sigma subunit. This sigma subunit, when required, that means when transcription is to proceed, actually binds to the core enzyme. So we are looking at sigma subunit. This sigma subunit, can you understand that it actually binds to the core only when it is required, when the process of transcription is about to take place, and this forms the complete enzyme. So core plus the sigma subunit will form the complete enzyme, and we will call this as holoenzyme. H-O-L-O, holoenzyme. Holo means complete. So this is the complete enzyme. So holo RNA polymerase actually has a core that is made up of 5 subunits, and there is a sigma subunit, and this sigma subunit will be brought to this particular core enzyme only when it is needed. One more important point to understand: with the help of this sigma subunit, the prokaryotic RNA polymerase will identify what is called as the promoter region of the transcription unit. I have already described in detail the transcription unit. I have already discussed the importance of the promoter region in a transcriptional unit. Please watch that video again. It is a very, very important video. And we know that RNA polymerase does not directly identify what is called as the structural gene, the gene that will actually carry the code for making the protein. It actually identifies a region that is upstream the structural gene, if you remember from that video, and is also located 5 prime to the structural gene. This region on the template of the DNA is actually called as the promoter. So it actually identifies the promoter, binds to it, and then transcribes what is there behind it. So that means this particular step of identification of the binding site of the RNA polymerase is actually facilitated by the sigma subunit. So very important point to understand. This RNA polymerase, there will be 3 steps. So I hope you have understood the prokaryotic RNA polymerase. So let us look into slight details about it. You know that the process of the transcription will be actually made up of, or will consist of, 3 steps. One would be initiation. I have just now given you the hint. So this would be initiation. The second would be elongation. And third would be what is called as termination. Now, the holoenzyme, if you read your NCRT, the holoenzyme will be capable of doing this and doing this. So these 2 steps can be done by the holoenzyme. This is a very important point. Read your NCRT nicely and please watch the video very carefully. What I am saying, the core enzyme is capable of elongating the nucleotide chain and as well as terminating the process of what is called as transcription. But the holoenzyme is capable of doing all. How is it possible? So this is possible with the help of what is called as the sigma subunit. So that means this process of initiation will require some proteins which are called as initiation factors. These initiation factors will be recruited to the promoter. So suppose this is the structural gene, this is promoter, there is a particular sequence in the promoter that will be identified by the RNA polymerase. This identification will be helped by the sigma subunit, but for that to happen, that the sigma subunit actually comes and attaches to the particular sequence in the promoter region of the prokaryotic DNA, there must be some initiation factors that must be present here, and one of the initiation factors is the sigma factors itself. So this is very, very important to understand, that it is actually the promoter that is being identified by the RNA polymerase. And let me give you another question. Now what happens, that there will be some sequences of nucleotides upstream from the structural gene. The first such sequence would be called as -1. The second would be called as -2, -3. You can understand I am giving a symbol minus because I am trying to say that this is before the structural gene. So the first sequence is called as -1, -2, -3, -4. And the most common sequence in prokaryotic promoter region that is identified by the sigma subunit of the RNA polymerase is actually a -10 sequence. And we will call this sequence as TATAAT. So please remember this. So this is a sequence that is actually identified by the RNA polymerase in the promoter region. Now this sequence is TATAAT. So please remember, this is DNA. This promoter is actually DNA, and therefore we are saying thymine. This is not RNA, this is DNA. I am talking of RNA polymerase that will form RNA on the template of DNA. So we are talking of template of DNA, and the template of DNA will be made up of deoxyribonucleotides, and hence I am giving you this sequence which is called as TATAAT, and we will call this sequence as Prinbow box. So a common question in entrance is, this is called as Prinbow box. There is another sequence that can be identified, but we do not need to remember every nitty gritty of the molecular genetics. So let us stick to the most important things, because we know that the exam, we have to study for a particular exam and we want result in that exam. So this is what we are saying, TATAAT, TATAAT, or the Prinbow box, the most commonly identified sequence by the RNA polymerase in prokaryotes. Correspondingly, in eukaryotes, we will call this particular sequence. This would be most commonly a minus 25 sequence. You can understand what now minus 25 actually means. It is called as the Tata box. It is called as the Tata box, or sometimes also called as what is known as Hogness box. So this is to differentiate between RNA polymerase and of prokaryotes and D and eukaryotes, the sequence that they actually recognize on the promoter. So I hope this thing is absolutely clear. How is it able to catalyze all the three steps? This is a very important in-text question that NCERT says. Now we know for initiation there will be initiation factors, for elongation there will be elongation factor, for termination there will be termination factors, and these factors will actually be proteins. And we know that the core enzyme is made up of 5 subunits, and there is another subunit which is actually called as the sigma subunit, and the sigma subunit and the core enzyme together form what is called as the complete enzyme or the holoenzyme. So I hope this discussion of the prokaryotic RNA polymerase is absolutely clear to those who are watching this video. Now let us pay some attention to the eukaryotic RNA polymerase. As I have already told you that in eukaryotes there is not a single RNA polymerase, so there will be at least 5 RNA polymerases that we know, and that are responsible for the various transcripts to be formed during the process of transcription. So we are looking at eukaryotic RNA polymerase, and we are saying that there are several of them. I have already told you the difference in the beginning as well. So now what I will want you to do is that I am going to show you a slide where the different types of RNA polymerases and the transcripts that they form is shown. And please carefully make a note of this particular thing. Try keep your notebooks and a particular pen ready with you, and try to make a list and try to remember this. See, what we are doing here, we are extending the NCERT to understand NCERT. So the basic message is that you cannot cram up the entire NCERT in one go, and it is important to understand the basic concepts. And therefore, because if something is given in my NCERT in a very condensed form, I have to come out and explain it so that that particular line remains in your memory. So what we are looking at right now is eukaryotic RNA polymerases. I know there are several of those, and can you see what exactly are the functions? So let me read them out to you. So if we are looking at RNA polymerase 1, RNA polymerase 2, RNA polymerase 3, RNA polymerase 4, and RNA polymerase 5. So we are actually knowing at least 5 RNA polymerases. Now I want you to remember RNA polymerase 1. It forms the pre-rRNA. So that means this is involved in the transcription of rRNA, and this rRNA is normally called as 45S, where S stands for Swedberg unit. So this S means Swedberg unit, the speed of the centrifuge at which a particular component from a cluster of things gets separated, and it is called as 35S in yeast. It matures into 28S, 18S, and 5.S. rRNA. We know that these rRNAs will be involved in the formation of ribosome. So they are the structural component of the ribosomes. Ribosomes are made up of rRNA and proteins. So we are looking at RNA polymerase that in eukaryotes actually transcribe rRNA. Pre-rRNA, they will mature into the final form or the rRNA. Very, very important. I will again discuss all these RNAs during the step of translation, but please try to remember them. And this is RNA polymerase 2. And look what I have written here. It transcribes pre-mRNA. This is a very, very important concept to understand. So I will come back to the table and I will just try to tell you something here. Please remember, do not commit this mistake. I am saying RNA polymerase 2, or I can write it as RNA polymerase 2. You know about the abbreviations. This transcribes pre-mRNA. So we are not directly saying messenger RNA, because I know that in eukaryotes there will be splicing. So in eukaryotes, please understand, in eukaryotes the genes, they will carry some non-coding sequences in between, and they are called as introns. So the primary transcript that is formed is actually containing the non-coding sequences as well, and therefore it is called as sometimes hnRNA or heterogeneous nuclear RNA or pre-RNA. We will have to remove the non-coding sequence. There will be some other post-transcriptional modification done. These post-transcriptional modification later on we will see is not required in a prokaryotic cell, but therefore I am writing it as a pre-messenger RNA. This is very, very important. So let us get back to the table again. So complete this list, and then we will say that this is actually also most snRNA, small nuclear RNA. You will understand during the process of splicing what is the role. And micro RNA, I have already told you, it will be involved in the regulation of the gene expression. And RNA polymerase 3, transfer RNA, and then another rRNA. So not all rRNAs are made by RNA polymerase 1. So this is very important, a transfer RNA molecule. This is the major transcript formed by RNA polymerase 3. So if you read your NCERT, it says rRNA, here it says pre-mRNA and tRNA. So just in case a question comes, please extend this knowledge. And look at the RNA polymerase 4. It forms small interfering RNA in plants. Again, just make a note of it. We will discuss small interfering RNA during the process of what is called as RNA interference, or a mechanism of gene silencing of pathogen in plants. So plants become immune because of antisense technology or RNA interference, and this small interfering RNA is actually used in that particular thing, as well as the micro RNA. So they are involved in gene expression. RNA polymerase 5, you can forget. I have written so many exclamation mark. You do not need to know anything about RNA polymerase 5. You can actually afford to leave this RNA polymerase 4 as well, but please try to understand completely RNA polymerase 1, RNA polymerase 2, and RNA polymerase 3. All the three enzymes have been mentioned in your NCERT textbook, and I have extended the particular knowledge that what is the complete thing that actually are making it. So I hope this is absolutely clear. Now finally we will see that if we compare RNA polymerase with, say for example, DNA polymerase. So if we look at RNA polymerase with respect to DNA polymerase, you remember that DNA polymerase had a big limitation. It could not start the synthesis of DNA. So it necessitated a formation of what is called as primer, if you remember, and that primer was actually a segment of RNA itself. And that time I told you that it is a very, very important thing to consider when we think that this is actually an RNA world. So initial, the metabolic machinery actually was evolved around this molecule RNA, and now we strongly believe that it is an RNA world. I have done a separate video on this topic given in NCERT, the RNA world, and with respect to evolution, with respect to molecular genetics, it will be very interesting to see that particular video as well. So which means we are saying that unlike this DNA polymerase, this can actually start the synthesis. So RNA polymerase does not require any segment that it will actually extend. It can start, we can say, de novo synthesis of RNA molecule. It can begin the synthesis. That was a limitation of DNA polymerase. I hope this is absolutely clear. Number two, this is very important. In eukaryotes, if you remember, when there was replication of DNA. So in replication of DNA, if you remember, we made a cut at ori. This led to the formation of replication fork. And we said that DNA can be replicated only and only if it has a particular origin of replication. And before that, we knew that there has to be a mechanism to unwind the molecule of DNA. So DNA is a coiled molecule. So before we started the process of DNA replication, if you remember, I told you it is important to uncoil, open up the DNA. And therefore you will require the cut at the ori as well. These hydrogen bonds had to be cut. And I use the word helicase for that enzyme that was actually doing both of them. It is sometimes also called as unwindase, if you remember. So it was simultaneously unwinding the template and actually helping in separating of them, opening it up. But we do not require any helicase in the case of RNA polymerase. The RNA polymerase itself is capable of doing this. So please understand, it opens up the helix itself. In RNA polymerase, you do not require an helicase. So this is a very, very important point of difference between what is called as a prokaryotic difference between DNA polymerase and RNA polymerase. Another important thing. Now we are coming to understand that even RNA polymerase has some intrinsic proofreading capabilities, though the error rate is much higher than that of DNA polymerase. So therefore, the fidelity is less. Fidelity of DNA polymerase is much higher than the fidelity of RNA polymerase. I have already told you in another discussion when I compared the different molecules, I said that RNA viruses replicate faster and evolve faster, and they have large scale changes, so that they mutate at a very fast rate. We already know that there are more likely to be errors during the formation of the RNA rather than the replication of DNA. So we are comparing DNA polymerase and RNA polymerase. So three very important points. Number one, I told you that this particular DNA polymerase will not be able to initiate the synthesis while RNA polymerase can. This was the number one point of difference between the two. And then we said that RNA polymerase itself acts as the helicase, if I can say so. That means actually I am trying to say that RNA polymerase does not require anything to open up the helix of DNA. It does not require a helicase enzyme. It is capable of doing it. And number three, we are seeing that though there is proofreading function in RNA polymerase, but what we are saying that the error rate during the formation of RNA is actually much higher than the error rate in the formation of DNA. Very, very important last point. Archaebacteria. If you look at the genetics of the archaebacteria, so archaebacteria, as I told you, is a bacterium. So it will also be having a single RNA polymerase. But this single RNA polymerase of archaebacteria is very similar to RNA polymerase 2. If you remember from that table, RNA polymerase 2 actually transcribed the pre-mRNA in eukaryotes. So there you are looking at a difference between archaebacteria and bacteria, and a similarity between the molecular genetics of archaebacteria and eukaryotes. And you know that now we say there are three domains actually, archaea, eukarya and bacteria, true bacteria. There are three domains. You have understood this particular concept during your discussion on the classification chapter. So what we are saying here is that this particular RNA polymerase of archaebacteria resembles the RNA polymerase 2 of eukaryotes. Actually, some of the transcription factors, the proteins that are required, also closely resemble those of the eukaryotes. So I hope before understanding the process of the transcription itself, now you are absolutely comfortable about the working of this very, very important enzyme, which is called as RNA polymerase. So in the subsequent videos, now we are in a position to actually discuss what exactly the transcription is all about. What are the various steps? Now we know about RNA molecules. We know the basics of transcription. We know how to describe a transcription unit. And we also know what exactly is RNA polymerase functioning like, and now we can discuss the actual steps of the process of transcription, that is the formation of major cellular RNAs on the template of DNA. This we will do in subsequent videos. I hope you have understood and enjoyed the video.